So we'll kick off the session without any further ado. I'd like to welcome Professor Henk Hogeveen to the stage. Henk holds a position in Wageningen and also in Utrecht University. He's certainly an authority on animal health economics and no stranger to the world of geriatrics either. So Henk, yeah. The floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Luke, for this introduction. Thank you for the possibility to be here. Thank you that you fill up the room quite neatly, given that many suitcases are there and many planes are leaving this afternoon. Great that that you are interested in this topic about economics. Luke already told you to keep your phones on silent, but you are allowed to use them since I have, on request of the organization, made a few questions that you can reach through the app. So if you are on the conference app and you go to this presentation, somewhere under this presentation there's a button called poll. If you go there, you got some questions. And the first question there is this one. What's the most heard argument of farmers not following your advice? And I have three options here. We do not believe your expertise. It's too expensive, or I am happy with the animal health status as it is. So maybe you can give the questions and then we'll see the results on screen. And also I showed up now. Well, I'll see whether it changes. It's a dynamic feature, I believe. So if there's other people answering the question, option three is catching up with option two now. If we catch up a little bit more, nobody with option one. Oh, well, okay. You know, as soon as I mention it, that's good. That's good. Well, let's continue now. My answer is option two, too expensive. It's an argument often used by farmers to not do something. And let me explain a little bit from some data that we had on work on herd health and management programs done by Marjolein Derks a couple of years ago in Utrecht. Where we interviewed lots of farmers about their participation in these types of programs. And as you can see, there is a bunch of people. You have farmers that do participate, farmers who quit, and farmers that do not participate. And it's quite interesting because the quitters and the non-participants used cost as argument. Second argument, low returns, which is the other side of cost, I guess. And, well, the third one is not practical advice or time-consuming. And, in fact, time-consuming is also a cost factor. Labor is a cost factor. While the ones that stayed in use different things. Higher output, well, that's an economic factor as well. But preventing blindness, structured work are some totally different items. But what this does, it does give the point to this presentation. Economics seems to be a burden for many, many veterinarians because we're always hit with that argument when farmers are not doing something. It's too expensive, it doesn't cost too much, what are the benefits, all these types of questions. So that's the reason I, in the title of my presentation, I use the word burden. However, if you look at a different perspective to the fact, and maybe a little bit more of the farmer's perspective, you come to something else. Because, especially at this moment, farmers have to work with volatile and currently low milk prices. Especially now, but the milk prices have been high as well. And if you look at this graph, you can see that, these are different years. 2016, that's this year, you see an exceptionally low milk price at the moment. This is EU average milk price. Some countries have a higher milk price, some have a even lower milk price. While in some other years, 2014, for instance, the milk price has been exceptionally high. By the way, this was just as exceptionally as this is. But we have to work with volatile milk prices, and one year you can have a good income, and the second year you have a bad income. And you can see the same thing on this slide, which is, again, is EU prices, where 2008 has a value of 100, an index value. And you can see that the gross margins have been quite high in the good years, but are decreasing even under 2008 and are very low at the moment, while Milk price as well, we talked about that, but also operating costs, milk price goes down, but operating costs do not go down as much as the milk price. So yes, economics are important for farmers. It's their daily existence. Maybe their goal is not to make as much money as possible, but their goal certainly is to feed their family and to have a family income. That means that economic management also is important. And because of these differences in margins, it becomes more and more important. Production diseases become also more expensive, and there's often there's hidden costs. Why are economics more important? It's important to support rational decision-making. It's part of that. Well, my presentation, because it was the introduction, has three elements. It's about cost estimates of production diseases as they are now. It's a bit of a literature review. A second item is about the complexity of decision-making. Why is it so terribly complex? I'm going to present a new tool that we developed to support farmers and their advisors to make calculations and, of course, the take-home message. Well, let's have a look at it. Well, these are the headings that you often see, because we do know that diseases cost money. Farmers know it, we know it, everybody know that. That's a thing. And often in journals, they have these items about costs of diseases, costs of reproductive problems, cost of this and cost of that. So there's nothing new there. The question is, how do we translate that knowledge to the farmers? I have read or I have heard that mastitis is very expensive, so let's talk about mastitis. It's probably not a proper approach because it's very unspecific. And how good publications are, and I really like them and I write them a lot, and I think it's very, very important to bring the news to the outside world. They're always generic. They're always averages. They might give some variation, but that's it. And for every farmer, it's something that is not of your farm. It's something of others. Because my farm is not the average. And of course, the farmer is right. His or her farm is not the average farm. So it brings me to the second question. What are, in fact, the costs of mastitis? 40 to 70 euros per cow per year, 70 to 100, more than 100, or all of the above? Well, make your choice, please. And I'm talking here per average cow per year. That means the average cow on the farm. It doesn't mean per case, but it means that per farm. Well, we see there's people that cannot choose, quite some people that cannot choose or do not want to choose. And you at least think it's quite expensive because the other group has more than 100 euros. Well, let's continue, because the correct answer is all of the above. These are the literature examples of the last 10 years, and you can see there's a few of them. There's two from the US, in fact from Cornell, one of Barr 2008 and one of Cha 2011. There's the other four are from Europe, and you see quite some variation. The two US ones are the cheapest. So probably a cheap country in one way or the other, or they didn't account everything or whatever. I couldn't dive into the details because their method didn't allow that. They didn't write about that. But you see here that, well, that's the quite cheap one. You see the Netherlands, two prices here, around 80 euros. And for Sweden, this one is a Swedish paper, it's around 200 euros. But in Finland, they came to an estimate of 191 euros. And they used the same approach as the ones there, so I couldn't dive into any details about it. For the Dutch data, it's quite interesting to see that the highest factors are not in treatments, are not for the veterinarian, but they are for things like milk production losses. And in this study, it's much more than in that study, but milk production losses are very important there. Also, culling is very important. And these are very indirect cost factors. You do not know. There's no bookkeeping agency, no accounting firm that writes down cost of milk production losses due to diseases so much. Of course, the veterinary bills are in there, but the other ones are not. So that's the thing. If you go to cost of lameness, well, same story. There's two studies, one from the Netherlands, one from the US, and both are around 50 euros. So there was a big difference in the studies around mastitis, but in the studies for lameness, they're both around 50 euros per cow per year. And for metabolic diseases, it has been an area that has not been studied for a long, long, long time. But recently, two studies have been coming out, one from France, from Didier Rabazon, in the room here, so I hope I reproduce correctly, where he says, where this one is the performances, where he purely looked at performance effects. Then he came to 257 euros per cow per year. If he put in all related diseases and the cost of those diseases, he came to a much higher amount of money. However, that's what you write as well, that's a big overestimation. And especially with metabolic diseases, you have to be very, very careful about what do you take into account. Because, yes, ketosis is a predisposing factor for many diseases. Of course, then there's a proportion of the cost of mastitis can be attributed to ketosis. But how much? That's the big question. How much is happening there? And it makes a big relation between epidemiology and economics there. From the US, from Susan McArt, in 2015, they came with a little lower estimate of 131 per case per year. So ketosis seems to be quite, it's hyperketomania, by the way. It's metabolic diseases are quite expensive in this case. We're working on these metabolic diseases ourselves, and we think that the costs are a little bit less than in these publications, but those data are not available yet. Now, there's a big problem because you see, saw all these different estimates. You saw all these different studies, all these different data. Can we compare the cost between studies or not? And can we use these numbers to support farmers in their decision making? Or is it difficult? Can these numbers support you in providing good support? Because farmers want support, but you as advisors also like to have some background in what should I work with. And that's quite a complex question. So let's go into that, the complexity of that one. This morning, Johannes Chalet gave a presentation. He talked about nematodes, and he talked about the possibilities to really take into account the farm economic circumstances in the animal health circumstances. And he does this with what we call production functions. And the production functions takes the resource input, say number of cows, money, labor, veterinary input, etc., and that's a link between that input and output. And the more you use a veterinary on your farm, the more you hire veterinarians, the more drugs you use, until a certain moment, of course, the more output you will generate, of course. The more cows you will have on your farm, the more output you generate. The more feed you buy, the more output. But of course, there is a moment that it turns down. You know, there's some kind of an optimum, then the marginal returns, as we say, will diminish, and at a certain moment, it even will be negative. Well, this would be a production function that is of a healthy herd, so that's quite high, and this is a production function of a herd that is not healthy, and no herd on earth is 100% healthy, so there's always will be some diseases, but of course there's herds that maybe have the function there and there's herds that have the function there, right? And now to look at the economic consequences, you can look at it this way. Suppose that a farmer is working on this part of the healthy chain. Now, given the diseases, there are two options. There's one option that you can say that's the one way to calculate. You say, well, in fact, in order to produce the same amount of output, I need more input. More veterinary service, more feed, more animals to produce the same output. You can understand that well. And the losses of disease are in more resources needed to the same production. Another way around is that, well, we keep the same amount of resources, and you just have less output. Those are two approaches to calculate the cost of disease from a real economic point of view. The problem is that most probably all farmers are somewhere here. Not one of these 100% lines. And you don't know where they are to start with. Because you do not know all these production functions. They differ. It's very difficult. And you can understand that the production function of this farm will differ from that farm and also from that farm. Right, given the fact that they're more intensive or more extensive, et cetera, so that's one problem of interpreting these economic effects. A second problem is, and then when you go to the literature, is that quite some different approaches are used. I didn't mention them, of course, but there's herd simulation models, there's dynamic bioeconomic simulation models, dynamic programming, whatever types of models, parts of budgeting, decision trees, a whole bunch of stuff is possible in methods in order to estimate things. And can you compare these methods? Well, maybe not. People in different studies use different input data. And I used four of these Mastitis studies, and if you look at these data, well, for instance, milk prices, this was under quota situation, so it was 12 cents. That was not the milk price, but it was the costs of milk production decreases. And if you do not have a quota, such as in the US and Europe nowadays, well, it's the milk price that you lose if cows produce less milk. That's differences. And both are the US, but this was in a year that the milk price was quite high, so they used that one, and this used a more average milk price in a year earlier. Well, it's an already 9 cents difference. Of course, these costs will be higher than those costs, right? Well, some we don't know, but look, for instance, at the cost of replacement. Well, quite some differences between the studies that we hear about. The value of labor, quite some differences. The cost of a veterinarian with euros per visit, well, quite some differences there as well. And of course, that might be the systems and what you calculate there, but this kind of makes results quite fuzzy. It makes also the different studies less comparable. And even in your own practice, when you go to two different farms, well, on the one farm, youngstock raising might be very expensive. In another farm, it might be quite cheap, just because of the circumstance of the farm, the fact that one farmer has more land than the other farmer has, et cetera, et cetera. So even within a small region, there might be big differences in various input factors. So that makes life difficult as well. A third item of what we do then is, because you have all these different approaches, modeling approaches, different types of animals, different production functions, and what we try to do in our own approach is to make this a bit more equal. So we say, well, let's take a pragmatic approach and let's kind of do and take a method that can be applied to most of these situations, take out the complexity a little bit, but be flexible enough to be used. That's kind of the vision our group has performing economic analyses. So that will bring us to a tool that we developed to estimate the cost effectiveness of disease prevention. Let's dive into that. It's based upon a straightforward analysis. And a straightforward analysis has two elements. The first element is what we call failure cost. And these estimates that I showed before about cost of mastitis, et cetera, that's what I call failure cost. We failed to prevent the disease, it's there, and there's cost associated. Basically, there are three groups of cost there. It's a group of treatment, maybe with some diagnostics involved there as well. The veterinarians, sometimes not. The drugs, labor to apply drugs, and discarded milk when that's needed. There's the group of losses. And losses are very invisible because the first group, the treatments, are very visible. If you ask Fowl what's the cost of the disease, well, he starts calculating and thinking about the bills that he got from his vet, and he comes to a quite good estimate of the cost of treatment, I think. However, the losses are different. Milk yield losses. Do you see milk yield loss of mastitis? Yes. When there's a severe clinical case of mastitis, you do see milk yield losses. But those milk yield losses are also during the time that you're discarding milk, so, well, I didn't deliver that milk anyhow. But a 5% on average lower milk production after clinical mastitis, do you see that? No, you don't. It might be 3%, it might be 7%, that's also some differences. But you do not see that amount of milk. So that's indirect, that's invisible losses. Growth reduction, for instance, when you talk about diseases in young stock or in beef cattle. Product quality, sometimes somatic cell counts. Mortality, well, that's quite visible. And culling, and sometimes even the culling is quite invisible because that's the culling that's associated with the cow that did have disease, for instance, metabolic diseases, and is just lower performing and is culled eventually after a couple of months. Most farmers do not link that culling to the ketosis it had earlier in the lactation, so that can be invisible as well. And then there's the thing of new cases of disease. Well, that's also quite invisible for farmers. So these are the failure costs. And in fact, we have quite good estimates of these failure costs because all these papers are there. Averages maybe, different methods, sometimes a little bit out of scope, but mostly quite okay. So those are failure costs, we have an idea about it. The second group that we have are the preventive costs. And the preventive costs, are more difficult because there's, of course, a wide range of preventive measures. So I don't put them in deadlines, but I put them in lines of there's always three cost factors involved. The first is labor. Never underestimate labor. Earlier in my career, I also did the same thing. Well, it's not too much work, right? You know, do this and do that, few minutes per cow per day or few minutes per milking, whatever. But farmers are working hard, are working 50, 60, 70 hours per week, and a few minutes per day is just a few minutes too much because I want to be in the house before 8 o'clock, otherwise I got problems with my partner. So that's about labor. Own labor is different than hired labor. Do we have 10 hired persons on a big farm? Well, it might mean 1 hour longer, which means 1 hour wage. Quite easy. But my own labor is different. The amount, of course, and the value. And especially the value of own labor is very often disputed. For instance, treatment cost of mastitis, how much does it cost? And we did ask at a certain time, we did ask farmers not what the labor costed, but what they were willing to pay to prevent that type of labor. That sounds a bit strange, but it brings much more the value. And there were farmers that said nothing. You know, I do have the time for that. I don't care too much. And there were farmers that said 50 euros per hour, which is much more than a wage, also in the Netherlands. So that's a big difference. And of course, some types of labor you are more willing to prevent than other types of labor. Some types of labor, driving a tractor on a nice summer night, might be the type of labor you like. But treating a cow in the weekends when you have to go to a party is something, a type of labor I do like to prevent. So there's quite some differences there. The second group are the investments. The equipment you need to buy or you need to change in the barns. Well, and that's relatively straightforward because it's a price of the equipment, it's a depreciation time, and it's an interest rate. And with that you can calculate the interest of your investment and you can calculate the cost for depreciation. And the third group are consumables. The amount of consumables used per cow or per day or per whatever, and there's a price per unit and you can multiply that. So in fact, per preventive factor, and there's of course thousands of different advices that you can give and thousands of different preventive actions you can ask a farmer to do, they can quite straightforwardly be calculated using this approach. But the big thing, of course, is to weigh these two. It's the weighing of preventive costs and failure costs. And of course, you can have put everything on prevention and have very low failure costs. That's okay, but maybe then your preventive cost will be too high. But sometimes some farmers like that because it's low levels of problems, no problems at all, I don't like diseases. Okay, maybe the costs of prevention are a little bit more than that. But that's an interesting process where you have to think about and talk about. Good, with that, the question is, do we know failure cost? I said we know on average. And this is the picture that probably many of you have already seen because it's my favorite picture and I've shown it in many, many presentations. It's already a few years old. But what we did here, on a hunch, when we went out calculating cost of mastitis for farmers, on a hunch we said, let's ask a first question. First the question, what do you think the costs are? Well, it was a great hunch. Because what you see is that these are the expected costs. So we first asked the farmers, what do you think? Ooh, man, okay, what do you think? Let me think last year, so much. And he came up with a figure. Mostly a nicely rounded figure, 1,000 euros, 5,000 euros, something like that. Right? Nicely rounded, that's here. And I expressed it in euros per cow, per year. Then we started using a very straightforward mastitis cost calculator tool to calculate the real costs. And they're here. And there's a few farmers, the blue ones here, those blue farmers, they were totally right. Pure luck or knowledge, I don't know, but they were totally right. There were some farmers that overestimated the cost. That's the green ones. Not much, but something. And there were a bunch of farmers that underestimated the cost. And man, if you are this farmer here, for instance, you thought it was around 50 euros per cow per year. In reality, it was 170 euros per cow per year. Oops. And in fact, under these groups of farmers here, I know that don't know which ones, but quite often farmers said, might be something to think about. That's why you want to have them, right? So they didn't think they have a problem. They thought they had a certain cost, but they did underestimate, and the real costs were differently. And these real costs were estimated with their data. They might be wrong. It was their estimation of numbers of cows, maybe underestimation. It was their estimation of the cost of milk production losses. It was their estimation of the amount of milk production losses. Well, the last one they hardly knew, so they often used the figure I gave, the 5% from literature. But by doing that, it became their figure. Yes, okay, I do agree. I don't have any reason to think differently. So it was really their estimation. So they don't know it. Do we know the preventive costs? Well, as I showed you, not too difficult to calculate. There's this thing about the value of farmers' labor, but it's quite doable. The big, big, big thing is, what is the reduction of disease? Yes, now I do propose that you are going to post-dip the teats of the cows after milking. How effective is that? Well, happily, for these types of measures, or the use of dry cow therapy or whatever, there are quite some studies in literature, and you can find something. Because there were companies that supported these types of research, and they published. But keeping your cows standing after milking, we think it's effective to prevent mastitis, right? Costs probably not too high, but how effective is it? Nobody ever did a clinical trial on the effects of keeping cows standing after milking. So it's our hunch. And of course, it differs from farm to farm, because if you have a farm with very good hygiene in the cubicles, well done, the effect will be lower of keeping your cow standing than when it's kind of the cubicles are, well, not very well. So it's very limited information from literature, differs from farm to farm, and you have to use your own expertise as a veterinarian. And it's good because you're experts, right? And you advise on many, many farms. And you evaluate, I hope, the effect of advice you've given before. And maybe you're the right person to make such an estimation. Farmers don't know, for sure. I do not know. I only know the literature, and I know it's not conclusive. But you guys are the ones that go out to farms, do advise, and see the effects, so you might know. We did some tool development within the project, EU project called IMPRO. There's a website of IMPRO, and IMPRO is a project aimed at organic farming, because also on organic farms, there are problems with health of cattle. Although consumers expect that the health of cattle is perfect, it's not the case. And it was aimed at designing an impact matrix analysis, some kind of a tool, and cost-benefit analysis to improve the animal health status. So what we did in this EU project, we developed a flexible tool, and we used what's called the 10-9 rules. You know, 10% of the time for 90% of the results. Yes, there's flaws in there. And all things are maybe a little bit straightforward. But to make them less straightforward, you have to spend much, much more time, both in modeling as well as in entering data. So that's the approach. Now let's look at that, what's happening, what's behind it. It's we look at first at the failure cost of production diseases, of a wide range of production diseases, mastitis, lameness, metritis, ketosis. A second step in the tool is that you select preventive measures. A third step in the tool is that you estimate costs of prevention. Either you use for some of the built-in measures, you use the given costs, or you take your own data. And you define the effect, that's the most hard part maybe, but if you do not define it for the preset preventive measures, we define it for you, so that's okay. And finally, it makes an analysis of the cost effectivity. Now, what's it working? This is how it looks like. It's called the Animal Health Management Tool. I guess I have to, and we have to think about a nice, catchy title, because this is not something that keep hold. We're not advertisers, we're not PR people, but we have to think about this a little bit. And you just started, it's an Excel thing, so you can use it on all Excel computers. As a next step, you don't try to read everything, but the first step is here, is that you get a bunch of questions about disease occurrence. First things about, how many of your dairy cows have been treated by a veterinarian for ketosis on your farm? Well, in this case, two. In a previous screen, you had to give how many cows you had and more stuff. So just an example. But also things like, what's the average received milk price last year? Well, here it's 45 cents. We dream of that nowadays. Feed cost per kilogram, all these kind of values can be entered farm specific. Besides things about disease incidences. Also questions about penalties, and there's a whole bunch of these quite straightforward questions that you can fill in for a specific farm. Next step then is that you get overview, and if you've done that, of the costs. These are just the failure costs, just the basics, and here's the losses of udder health for this farm, and the next step is loss of lameness, and you can scroll down. I don't do that, but you can scroll down to see all the costs of all the production diseases. And for instance, this one here, it's split up for the clinical cases, subclinical cases, cost for veterinarian medication, well, because it's for organic farming, homeopathic treatment, we made it zero now. Labor costs, culling and destruction, and a total 11,600, well, 38 euros per cow, a total per year, which is 116 per cow per year, which is more than the cost was set, but milk production was quite expensive here. And also cost per case. Yeah, these are just some example figures. There are no average at all. As a next step, you can say, well, given what I've seen, I think I want to do some analysis on prevention for mastitis, lameness, scotosis, or metritis. Or I want to do all, which I don't recommend because that's a lot of work, but maybe one or another one. So you can choose for which disease as the next step you want to go on and do some analysis. And then you get a bunch of preset preventive measures. These were, again, the preventive measures for mastitis. There's some above there. For instance, all cows are dried out with an appropriate antibiotic. Well, we have heard a lot about antibiotics and selective and blanket dry cow therapy. So I said, that's not the thing. I want to add one management which we didn't build in, and that is we're going to apply selective dry cow therapy. So you enter that, and you check the box, and then you continue. If you do continue, you got some specific questions for this new method because it wasn't built in, so we don't have built in any cost for the preventive measure. So you have to think about how much labor you expect, how often per year, some investments, yes or no, depreciation time. So some stuff that to be filled in to calculate the cost of this preventive measure. And then you'll get the results. There's a bunch of figures and data on the results. I show just a figure that's given because it gave the current situation here, which is the cost, which was the 11,000 something euros per year costs, and this would be the new situation given the effectiveness that's brought in, given the cost. And it says, well, the total cost for mastitis now will be a little less than 10,000, which consists of a little more than 6,000 for the failure cost. And yes, I did make cost for prevention, right? But overall, the total will be lower. That's what's given. Given all your assumptions. If you want to, you can dive deeper into the model and change all kinds of assumptions about effectivity, et cetera, et cetera. But I didn't show you that. So, there's much more to say about this model. Felix van Soest, who in fact made the model, is presenting later on in this session and presents some results that he got for different farms in different countries. So you have to use it yourself. It's available online. We call this a beta version because all kinds of things might be wrong. So if you have feedback, please let us know. It's available at our website. It will be very soon be available at the Impro website. And, well, this is a QR code that you can use to find it. So to finalize, some final things. First, a question. Now, after this presentation, what do you think? For the veterinary practitioner, economics are, A, a burden, still. B, a blessing. Or an opportunity. C, still very difficult. What do you think? I'm happy about these results. Oh, wait, but there's still very difficult people are catching up. I need some blessing votes, guys. No, and a burden, good. Okay, well, let's continue. Yes, I think there's a big opportunity there, but it's difficult. I totally agree. And for some of the vets, it might still be a burden and remain a burden because if you don't understand what's happening, you always will wait for the answer. But it, in my opinion, it needs to be a part of what we're doing. Further costs of diseases are large, period. There are big differences between farms, yes, certainly. So you can't use a one-size-fits-all approach. We do need estimation at the farm level, and it's a way to talk about it. It's also a way to talk about the proposed effects. What do you think about it? What do you think, dear farmer? Then immediately you find out that the farmer might not believe in a certain measure, while you believe in it. Well, that's also give an opportunity for discussion. So at the side of such a program, that you fill in maybe together, you can work things out and you can really talk about beliefs and about effects and about what's happening. So that's very important there. What we know as well, and it has been mentioned quite often today also, maybe yesterday as well, but I arrived only yesterday, there's more than only economics to motivate. Yes, for sure. And there's quite some publications out there that show it. You know, Jolande Janssen did a PhD on communication and mastitis, and well, attitude explains the mastitis situation more than technical results. Campaigns do influence the mastitis situation. But also from an economic side, some farmers behave irrational from an economic point of view. And cost factors are not always regarded as being equal, although we thought they were remained to be equal. And this is kind of a theory that's explaining this. This is a theory from social psychology that we're using and applying more and more often. This is the thing that we have behavior. Well, we like to influence behavior, right? There's the intention, and that's the best prediction of behavior there is. Of course, it's not one-to-one. But these are three factors that do influence. It's the behavioral beliefs of a farm. That means, yes, I do think mastitis is a problem. Yes, I do think that mastitis does affect welfare. Yes, I do think that it's good for the image of milk in the world, whatever. These are the normative beliefs, while in fact, my neighbors don't think it's important. And it's more important than you think of that, because we are all kind of group animals, aren't we? Group human beings. Normative beliefs, subjective norms. The others don't think it's a problem, so I don't mind as well. And these are what's called perceived behavior controls. That am I able to do it? And in fact, our economics are affecting this one. Yes, it is cost effective. You do have the money. It does pay back. So we only affect one part of the total part of intention. If we don't take these seriously, it might go wrong. But this is an essential part. This might be very well, but the farmer says, I don't have the money for it. And that's really I don't have the money, given low milk prices. There might be very, very, very good attitudes. The norms might be good, but then it still doesn't happen. So it is important there. So finally, yes, economics are useful, necessary to support decisions on animal health. And it's a challenge, and you have to go for that. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hank. That was a fantastic talk. I'd like to open the floor now for questions. If you can raise your hand, there's mics roving around the room. And we'll... Blown away.
It's too difficult, you know.
Well, as people are thinking of some questions, I might ask you one, Hank. Was there a hand up there?
Okay. No, we got questions.
Hi, my name is Sina, practitioner. I was wondering about, you showed in the beginning a graph of input versus output, basically. And we're discussing a little bit around, I was wondering about your thoughts on welfare and input-output, because I seem to recall some curves that are more U-shaped, where you actually have a very low input but still get a high output.
Yeah, that's another thing. I didn't discuss welfare at all here. And of course, one of the reasons that we are not only willing to support farmers with their decisions, which is a neutral thing, we want to improve welfare of animals, so we in fact want farmers to take up more preventive measures, right? Why? Because we think farmers might make some more money, but as well because we think that the animal welfare should be improved. So that's our personal motivation. And from an economic point of view, welfare is what we call an externality. For a farmer, it doesn't mind very much in terms of making more money. So he might take decisions that are good for the economics, but bad for welfare because it's good for economics. And if ill farmers do that goes wrong. And if that's important for us as well as society, then we have to take this into account in subsidies or in regulation or in stimulating formats. It's the same thing as like with pesticides. And in such a curve, the welfare, it depends on what you're looking at. For welfare, we can make an equal graph. If you improve welfare, take more measures to improve welfare, we see an increase in welfare, but I do not think that the welfare will go down at a certain level. You know, what you do see, and that's a totally different type of graph, is the costs per unit of increased welfare. And those are interesting things to look at, and we're just starting a little bit with that, because what are the measures you best can take to improve welfare, and what's the first steps to do? You know, the first steps, in fact, might deliver money. You know, that's what we often say. If you increase health, that does increase welfare, and it doesn't cost you, it does provide you money. That's also more and more an argument that I think we should use to farmers to motivate them, because you know, farmers always, oh no, society wants to increase welfare, may more costs. But through health, you can improve welfare without more costs often, even some benefits. So I hope this answers your question. Yeah.
Good. Okay, we have a question up at the back as well.
Joachim Kleen, Car Consult Germany. I'm afraid, Henk, I've got a tricky question for you. What I'm increasingly experiencing is something that I would like to call economic congestion in a farmer's head, as a lot of sales reps are bombarding the farmers with cost estimates on whatever basis and method they may have used. And I try to make some interesting talks to them and saying, well, these are the actual costs. But as I said, there's a congestion. How may I overcome this congestion? What's your idea?
Yeah, well, that's an interesting question indeed, Joachim. Do we have a few minutes? No. Maybe to be very short, personally, I think that the veterinary advisor, in a role of advisor, should be the independent person about what to do to improve health. And that means that if there is this sales rep that comes with this nice calculation, of course, these calculations are always cost-effective, right? Otherwise, you don't use them. You know, you might have tried it, but it was negative, then we leave it out. That's what happens. That means that you can redo this. And I hope that many farmers have this idea, well, I got a sales rep, and he came to me with this stuff. Is this something? Can you, you know, give me advice on that? And then you could redo these calculations, in fact. Say, okay, what do we expect from this measure? Do we think that the effect that the sales rep tells you it is, that it also works on your farm or not? And that means there should be one person that might be the person to advise you on it. And for instance, accountants are not good persons to advise on costs and benefits of health measures. They have the overall accounts of the farm, but not on the specific, because they purely lack the knowledge about diseases. And you guys have, but you have a lack of knowledge in economics, and you should have the basics of that. But that would mean that you, as an independent advisor, can kind of redo this together with the farmer, and yes, is it something or not? And of course, you learn from the same time, because you can apply this knowledge the next time. So while we calculated for farmer Jochemsen, and we found out that it was not really effective. And maybe you should do this, you know, because you kind of know these sales reps, right? You know these brochures, so why not do this yourself once? And make this recalculation, think, man, this is totally silly. Oh, wait, quite good.
Okay, do we have any more questions? Okay, Henk, I'm going to squeeze in my question quickly here then. In terms of, you mentioned the production functions that are there. Animal health is obviously only one input that you could put in there. Do you think veterinarians would need a better understanding of perhaps the whole farm system production to understand, you know, where does it lie in the farmer's priorities in terms of if it is a profit-making, maximizing type of farmer?
Yeah, I think that's very, very, very important. You know, the knowledge should be a little bit further than only being able to fill in the tool. Often, veterinarians don't come very much further than that. There's very good veterinarians that do come further, because if you do understand relations on a more theoretical basis, and that's, of course, a much more boring basis, then you also can place it a bit better in perspective. These production functions are very great to use with things like overstocking. Because with overstocking, you see many more cows in the same barn means, you know, diminishing production. At a certain moment, even a lower total output. And that's exactly also where many discussions are between vets and farmers about overstocking. And the farmer says, overstocking is bad, production per cow goes down. Yeah, you're right, but the total production might still go up, so maybe the farmer is right, depending on prices, et cetera, et cetera. By the way, that's despite the welfare thing, especially in overstocking, you're talking about welfare as well. But yes, a little bit better background in the basics, would help in interpreting and just being a little bit more secure in advice that you give. And if a farmer says something, because farmers often say something and sounds very nice and rational, but they might be wrong.
Okay, thank you very much, Hank. If you give Hank another round of applause.